So, what's up, guys? So, this week's video, I don't really have a whole lot, as it's kind of coming up on Thanksgiving. Tomorrow will officially be Thanksgiving. So, not really I can really say, except, well, to those that have been getting pissed off over some of the things I've put on Facebook or the things I've talked about on YouTube, you know, I'm sorry, but I'm going to probably continue doing some of those things. I have my own personal opinions of friends of mine that we kind of agree on certain issues, and other issues we kind of have a slightly different opinion, but mostly amongst a lot of things, the people that I entertain, basically, you know, typically seem to, we all seem to have this relative consensus that there's nothing really to be afraid of when it comes to Muslims and Arabs, and nothing to be feared from Syrian refugees, considering that the refugees were mainly of European nationalities. So, yeah, it's this whole point of kind of knowing all the factors involved and everything else. So, to those that are getting pissed at me, I'm sorry, but, you know, when I'm posting stuff that I actually have information on, I'm not just pulling it out of my ass, I'm actually getting it from a lot of sources. So, my point being is, you know, to those that are getting offended by it, I'm sorry, but it's my opinion, and if you have a different opinion, that's fine. I encourage debate. That's the whole point of having this channel. That's the whole point of me having a Twitter. That's the whole point of me having the Facebook pages set up and stuff like that. I encourage debate with people. If you have an opinion, bring it forward. You know, if you have another source that discredits my sources, bring it forward too. I have nothing wrong with that. I entertain the ideas of other people. I'm not being arrogant, self-centered, or, you know, egotistical. You know, I actually do try to do the best, bring forth the best information I can, and give my own analysis and opinion. Just pretty much like any other schmuck that's on YouTube. You know? So, and it, to the people that are basically trying to say that my views are Nazi-esque, or that they're, you know, somehow, you know, fascist in some way, I don't really see how my views are fascist when I'm not censoring people, I'm not forcing somebody to watch my videos, I'm not forcing my opinions down people's throats. People choose to be here, they choose to comment, they choose to subscribe. They choose to do what they, you know, do what they please here, and I, you know, as long as you're not being radically offensive, you know, saying, you know, using racial slurs or derogatory comments towards, towards a certain group of people, I typically tend, most people will tell you, I tolerate a lot on here, so, you know. The only things I really delete are things that, you know, delete or don't really allow on my YouTube or anything else are overtly, you know, blatant offensive comments and spam. That's pretty much, you know, as long as there's not that, I pretty much allow everybody to comment. So, and, you know, again, the general consensus with the people that follow me or are close to me typically happen to have, you know, either the same or relatively similar viewpoints to what I have, especially regarding issues like Paris and Islam and Arab people. And when I've also mentioned the whole idea that you're twice as more likely to be killed by white supremacy and by Christian fundamentalism, I did a video on that, and I have a source for that that's based upon a study done about that. You know, so if you don't want to believe that information, you are fully within your right to do so. For me personally, you know, it's one of those things where I'm just on here doing the best work I can possible, in the best circumstances I can possible, to bring to my audience. If people don't like that, then I'm not really forcing you to watch it, I'm not forcing you to read my bullshit, and you can go upon your merry way. There's no need to be, you know, there's no reason to, you know, basically, you know, have the argument that, you know, that, oh, I'm, you know, to basically go to the Godwin's Law area where I'm being a Nazi or I'm, you know, blah, 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 whatever the, you know, whatever the reason is. You know, I'm not here to, as I've said before, I'm not here to please anybody. I'm really not. I have friends and family that watch this, and I'm not here to please any of them. I'm here to do what I want to do, what my audience wants me to do, and hear. And essentially, I'm just doing the best content that I possibly can do. Plain and simple. That's what I've stated numerous times. That's what I stated at the end of season 12. That's what I stated at the beginning of this season. That's what I stick by. That's where I'm going with. I'm going to be doing videos that will offend people because reasons. You know, I'm going to be saying, you know, things to, you know, I'm going to say things that might, you know, I say things that basically I try to give another perspective that maybe people have not ever thought of. And if by some happenstance I happen to strike a nerve by bringing up that perspective, then, you know, I'm sorry. But that's my personal opinion. That's the perspective I put out there. And if people don't like that perspective, they don't have to subscribe to that particular perspective. They can remain on the side of the mainstream perspective or middle ground perspective. They don't have to. I'm not forcing you to believe what I believe. And that's never been my intention. I remain objective, yet I have a biased opinion. My analysis is objective, but my opinion may be biased. That's the whole point of this show. I've always stated that I'm not exactly an independent source, and I'm definitely not any, but at the same time, I'm not a corporate shill like CNN or MSNBC or, you know, one of their little cronies that works for them. You know, I do objective analysis from a Marxist perspective, and I have an opinion that I give usually during the end of every, somewhere within or at the end of every video. And yes, that opinion is my opinion, so of course it's going to be biased. But to basically say that, oh, that I'm forcing something upon somebody, I'm really not. I'm not forcing anybody to subscribe to to the views that I have. But, you know, if you believe that I'm somehow doing that, that's on you. I'm not trying to be I'm not trying to be some asshole. Yes, am I arrogant? Exceedingly. Yes, I am fucking arrogant. And it's something that I do have to work on. I've apologized for my arrogance in the past. But I'm not going to apologize for having the opinions that I do. I'm not going to apologize for the stuff I put on social media, because that's my opinion. I have a right to free speech. I have a right to my opinion, just like anybody else does. So to all the people that are opposed to my leaning, to my viewpoints, that's your opinion. Go ahead. I'm not saying that you can't believe what you want to believe. All I'm trying to do is I'm just trying to give give another perspective for people to think about. That's what I'm simply here for. I'm out here to give another perspective that many people wouldn't normally typically find from anybody else. So, you know, I typically tend to do a lot of things that the media doesn't necessarily cover or doesn't want to cover. I talk about a lot of things that, you know, might give another perspective than what the media, you know, hardline is typically about. I expose certain information that typically a lot of groups don't necessarily want to talk about or expose. It's because I am not affiliated with any other group. I do not bow to any other organization. I am purely a freelance, you know, person on here. I'm an amateur, freelance journalist, reporter, whatever you want to fucking call me. YouTuber is what I call myself. But I bring information and news and things like that, you know, from completely another perspective that's not under any other oversight from any other organization. This is completely, you know, ham radio like, essentially. Essentially, that's what this is. This is 21st century ham radio. It's just internet ham radio is essentially what it is. So, yeah. My opinions are my opinions. You can say that my opinions are complete bullshit. You can say that I'm, you know, whatever. I don't really give a shit. I really don't. I'm not here to please anybody. I'm here to do what I've always been doing, and that I'm getting quite better at, and that people are responding to, and have been actually garnered a lot of positivity from. It's also the reason why my view count and my subscriber count keeps growing. So, yeah, I really, you know, so obviously I'm doing something right, and I'm going to continue doing what I've been doing right for the last, several years, and definitely for the last several months for whatever I've been doing right. I'm just going to continue on that path. So, that's basically what I'm opening with. In doing so, let me talk. I'm going to move away from this week from talking a lot about. I'm going to try to get away from the things about ISIS and Paris and Islam and Arabs and, you know, a bunch of, you know, people that, you know, want to assume that all of them are evil and blah, blah, blah. We shouldn't accept Syrian refugees, blah, 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 because, you know, whatever reason. I'm going to get away from all that because, you know, that stuff just brings negativity. What I wanted to talk about was something that I brought up in one of my videos, the special announcement a couple days ago. And that is that I'm currently in the process of setting up an interview with Kayla Moon from Future of Minds. She contacted me via YouTube a few days ago and wondered if I would be interested in doing a piece on California independence, which I've always supported, even before there was a California independence movement. So she recently sat down with Marcus Ruiz Evans and spoke to him in a 25-minute interview about California independence and about what Yes California is all about. Now, she's also wanting to set up a interview with me, which would be done completely over Skype. It would be a much shorter, though, 5 to 10 minutes. But she would, basically it would be a Skype interview that would be going on with me, and I have agreed to it, because I would like to speak on that particular subject, as I would any other subject. So, I will be answering any questions she has, and, that's one of the things that I was talking about the other day. I think that'll be really great for them to hear my perspective. I think it'll be really good to get my voice out there and everything else. And personally, I think that it would be a... I just think it would be really good for this channel and for my audience. So, yeah. In that aspect, let me also speak for a moment on that whole thing, California independence, on independence in general. I've spoken in the past about certain things such as the independence of Scotland, the independence of Texas and different things, the independence of, in the past I had supported the independence of Donetsk and Ukraine and Venice and as well as Catalonia. There's a lot of groups that I believe that if you want independence, you should have it. The Kurds, for instance, I believe deserve an independent state. There's probably at least 500 different nations within the world today. But there's a difference between a nation and a nation state. You can be a nation, be a nationality. You can be, you know, you can be all that, but not actually be a state. There's a vast difference between actually being a group of people that identifies as a nation, but don't actually have sovereignty. That's where nation states come in. And in this case, a nation state would be a society like the US, UK, France, China, Japan. Those are nation states. A nation itself would be something like Kurdistan or California. Those are nations. Those are, you know, groups like that. Scotland is a nation. Catalonia is a nation. But they're not nation states. So that's where typically nationalism, like regionalism, nationalism, and these independence movements come out of. That's the whole point of California wanting to be, certain Californians wanting to be a nation, nation state. Why Scotland's advocating to become a nation state, why Kurdistan has fought for years to be a nation state. And even right on down to Catalonia. Now, Catalonia has been facing a lot of issues. One of the biggest issues they faced as of recent has been their arguments going on with the Spanish government. Now, typically, I don't normally... my personal opinion about Catalonia is that it would be more of a very bourgeois democracy. It would be a very... it would probably almost be oligarchic. But still, the whole fact is that Catalonia wants to be an independent nation state. They have full right to do so. I support any idea that they want to become a nation state. While I don't really support the idea of what they will become, I believe that they at least have the right to their own self-determination. It's kind of the same reason why when it comes to the idea of Quebec being its own country, I support the idea, but I think that the idea is also fairly flawed. And it's kind of the same with Catalonia. I support the idea of them being independent from Spain, but I think the idea the idea would be fairly flawed, because the idea seems good on paper. Actually applied, how well would that actually go about? And I also apply the same idea when it comes down to California. It's one of those things that doesn't really seem like it would be an easy idea. Would it be easy? No. Would it be practical? That's arguable. But at the same time, the idea of gaining independence is definitely is definitely a good idea. Every nation in the world has a right to its own self-determination. It has a right to a level of autonomy. It has a right to a level of representation. It has a right to a level of sovereignty, etc. And that's no different from Catalonia. That's no different from Scotland. It's no different for Kurdistan. It's no different for California. And Catalonia lawmakers have recently voted for secession from the Spanish government, and this has actually caused a lot of issues. According to the Wall Street Journal, the 72-63 vote, Catalonia's regional parliament approved a roadmap towards secession, a 9-point plan that moves the region towards becoming independent within 18 months, and the first phase of the plan calls on Catalonia's parliament to start writing laws creating independent social security and tax authorities within 30 days. This is also something similar to one of the issues being raised when it comes to California's independence, and I think has been one of those things that's also been a big issue when it comes to Scotland gaining its independence. And one thing I want to lay down here was the fact that since the referendum in Scotland in September 2014, there's been a lot of people that have felt like they've been duped by the UK government, and justly so, because the UK government basically flat-out lied to them, along with every one of their little unionist alliance partners that pretty much got in on it. So they basically duped them, saying, oh yeah, you can get your devolution. Yeah, it didn't happen, and now a lot of people in Scotland feel duped, and they should, because basically they were, you know, they were conned. And when you look at the fact that the poll on Scottish independence was pretty fucking evenly matched, yeah, I think Scotland would probably vote different. You don't have to look very further than May 2015 general election, in which the SNP gained pretty much a vast majority of votes throughout Scotland and ended up becoming the third largest political party in Britain. And there's even a lot of people within England itself and within a lot of other places that believe that Scotland should have its independence. But none is more prominent than in Scotland itself. In fact, a poll actually, something that I've actually come across that I haven't recently been able to bring up as of yet. I'll try to find it and put it in the description if I can. But I think someone happened to have told me somewhere along the line that it was like 60% of the people would actually now support an independent Scotland, and that's a pretty very different percentage and a very different number than we saw from 1 year ago. And I think it's funny because there's a lot of people that if they could have, they would have voted for SNP that were in England and other places, because, you know, a lot of people, one, believe Scotland should be independent, and frankly, that's the SNP could do a better job of running a government than, you know, the Conservatives or the Labour Party. But it's the whole fact that it's also drawn this surge of nationalism in Wales and Northern Ireland, and even in England, which frankly I don't see why they need independence, considering they basically are the ones that are dominating the Westminster system. Duh. But yeah, but essentially, like anything else, Scotland deserves its independence too. And one of the issues that has always been very key has been this issue about social security, about these different welfare systems, national emergency services, what currency we're going to use, blah, 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 blah. These are all situations that many nations face when considering the idea of becoming a nation state. Even down to California, we are facing a lot of these same issues, such as what would we do in the case of Social Security? We would have to be creating our own independent Social Security program. what would we do when it comes down to if, say, the drought in California continues to persist? Or if we even get over this, what happens if we face another drought? How would we face that on our own? We have to set up plans for that ahead of time. Our economy, our economy is based upon entertainment, technology, and agriculture. That's essentially what California is, what its economy is based on. Not only that, the import and export of different products. California has a very large GDP. We pay $26 billion a year to the federal government in taxes. That money, better well spent, could be spent on a lot of other, programs. It also is the 10th largest economy in the world. So we would actually, in the global department, we could actually be part of that G20 or the G10 or many other different groups. We actually could be part of this greater community and stuff like that. And I think up there would also be Scotland as well. So there's a lot of similarities going on between California, Scotland, Catalonia. That's why it's important to really address these issues when it concerns our independence movements. Now, granted, Scotland's independence movement is larger than California's. Catalonia's is larger than California's, and frankly, it's one of those. And frankly, I think Scotland's independence movement's probably a little bit more prominent, maybe. I don't know, larger, but I think prominent's probably the right word. But all these independence movements are very important in their different aspects. So when it comes down to Catalonia trying to gain its independence from Spain, they're going to face the same issues that Scotland and California are going to face. And frankly, one of the biggest issues I think that's faces all three, and has definitely been a concern when it came to Scotland's independence, is what to do when it came down to military bases. For instance, I forgot what the particular name of it was, but there's a British military base of strategic importance up there along the North Sea coast, and it would be what would be done about that. California faces a similar issue when it concerns a lot of U.S. military bases that are here. For instance, one of the military bases that comes right off the bat to my mind is one that's very near to me, Travis Air Force Base. Travis Air Force Base is the gateway to the Pacific. It's been around since pretty much the last days of World War II. It's been a strategic Western importance. It's been basically the last Western flyout, the last Western stop before people fly out to other countries or other bases, such as Pearl Harbor or to the Philippines or Afghanistan. Even it's usually been the last stop for many troops. There's also strategic military bases such as Camp Pendleton and Coronado. These are bases of importance along California's Southern California's coast, and what would be done about those. And then we've of course got the proving grounds in the Chocolate Mountains and China Basin in the Mojave Desert. What would be done about those? So there's a lot to talk about on that. And I don't think Catalonia is... I don't think Catalonia is alone on that, because I think Catalonia, because I don't know exactly a lot about Spanish military areas, but I wouldn't be surprised if Catalonia isn't facing a similar issue like that, even if it's on a smaller scale. Because, as well as the fact that basically Spain mooches off of Barcelona's immense wealth, it's the fact that Spain they're really being very stuffy about the whole idea of just letting Catalonia go. So there's a lot of different issues with that. Recently, Spain's Prime Minister Mariano Rajoy unequivocally rejected Catalonia's secession, saying, "I've said it continuously and reiterated today, the government will not allow this to continue. Catalonia is not going anywhere, nothing is going to break." Which essentially means that Spain has put its foot down and say, "We don't give a fuck what you say. You want out? Too bad. We want to keep you, and that's how it's going to stay." And that is really just a very... It's really just kind of that line in the sand sort of issue. It's just a really hard-nosed and very typical sort of, I would say, authoritarian stance. And so it's really one of those issues that you... And the reason why I say it's authoritarian is because at least when it came down to... basically came down to the British Unionists. At least they were the ones that were pretty much trying... The British Unionists were at least saying, even though they were outright lying, at least they were basically telling Scotland, "We'll give you devolution, we'll do this, we'll do that." At least they played the card that they were open to it. At least they played, even if they were just opposed from it from the beginning, at least they played it off pretty well. The Spanish Prime Minister and the Spanish government right out just says, they were against even holding a referendum. Right from the get-go, they were just like, nope, screw you, fuck you, it's not even up for discussion. At least Britain allowed Scotland to have a referendum. And at least in California, we haven't been shut down on the idea yet. We're holding a petition to bring our independence referendum to the ballot box. So at least we're allowed to do that. Spain is telling Catalonia to fuck itself. And I think that it speaks enormous authoritative volumes. It just really is one of those things that I wanted to bring up, because I think when it comes down to the whole situation, Catalonia, Scotland, California, we all face similar issues. We're all Western countries that face immense challenges. We all face immense... We face immense economic issues and financial burdens and stuff like that that would come with us gaining independence. There's a lot facing us. Not only that, what would be the political situation that would evolve from us separating from our countries that we were originally, attached to? Essentially, the Siamese twin separation sort of deal. What would happen if we have, what would be the political situation of us breaking free there? Because, as we can see from Catalonia, it does not seem like it's going to come without Catalonia, outright fighting for it. It does not seem like Catalonia or the Basque country or any other country that has these independence movements coming out, doesn't look like they're going to be able to just peacefully secede or peacefully vote for independence. It's not going to probably come without some sort of fight, and if not, tremendous political turmoil and fallout in some cases. Scotland and the UK, there might be some tensions, but I think they'd get over it. California and the US, sure, we'd have some divide. There would even be some very pissed off American citizens. Even some grumblings between, the two, party dominant system that it exists in the U.S. There would probably be some infighting over that, but nothing hopefully ever too major. Whereas Catalonia, Catalonia could literally and very easily have to fight its way out. It could literally, I mean, it's one of those things where it could, if worse came to worse, they could literally end up fighting a independence movement, movement like the Revolutionary War in the U.S. It could simply be something like that. But I don't know. I can't predict the future. These are just a few things to kind of keep in mind. It's just one of those things that we have to entertain the idea of what could happen, the perception of what next, what now, you know, what can we learn that we haven't, that we didn't do previously that maybe we could apply now? Is it too late to do this? You know, is it practical? What, you know, it's these different what ifs. So really it's going to be important to look at Catalonia's independence. It's good to look back at the Scottish referendum and even the future of another Scottish independence referendum and the future of the Scottish independence movement, as well as to look at the growing California independence movement and really see what happens there. Because all three of us, though vastly different in our politics and our economics and everything else, our independence movements are very similar. And so it is going to be very important to look at all three and see how that progresses within the future. So that's what I wanted to talk about this week. I'm NorCal Nick, leader of the revolutionist movement, and this has been NorCal Corner. Later.